Good afternoon, everyone. We welcome you for the CCR presented by our Department of Neurosurgery. The topic, the Balancing Act Neurosurgical Workflow During the COVID-19 Pandemic. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all for the CCR presented by our Department of Neurosurgery. The topic is the Balancing Act Neurosurgical Workflow During the COVID-19 Pandemic and the Challenges Faced and the Lessons Learned. To introduce, present the introductory remarks, I would like to invite Professor Suri, from the unit head of the department, to the dais.
Online. Well, good afternoon. The last 9 months have been very difficult, full of a lot of challenges and a lot of lessons we have learned. And for a high outflow and a department like neurosurgery, this pandemic has been full of challenges. And we would present from our department what all we learned regarding the regimes that we followed regarding the workflow management, the triaging as well as the testing, and because normally we treat patients who are at high risk, but here even the surgeons and our the team are also at high risk. And before I start, I would like to thank all the corona warriors, our faculty, residents, nursing staff, technicians, who really fought it out for the last 9 months. Can we start?
Now I would like to invite our resident, Dr. Nivedita, to start the proceedings.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon. So our strategies for COVID-19 management were divided into the following 5 subcategories: reorganization of manpower and infrastructure, clinic scheduling and telemedicine, contact surveillance, surgical scheduling, as well as revamp of the neurosurgical training and education. So coming to reorganization of manpower and infrastructure, so based upon the clinical expertise of the residents and the staff in the management of critically ill patients, as well as ICUs and HDUs, they were redesignated to the COVID-19 designated areas. And in addition, 25% of our faculty as well as residents were allocated to the COVID-19 task force. In our department, prior to the pandemic, we functioned as 2 units, both in the main clinical department as well as in the neurotrauma center. Once the lockdown began, we dissolved our unit system to form 3 teams which were rotated on a weekly basis. At the end of the lockdown, and once the restrictions were relaxed, we dissolved the teams to form 2 separate units which were subdivided further into teams which rotated on a weekly basis. During both these phases, 25% of the residents as well as the faculty were assigned to the COVID task force. There were significant changes to our infrastructure. Our bed strength, which was at 171, including the main clinical department as well as trauma center, was reduced to nearly a third, to just 70 beds. In addition, the total number of our OTs was reduced from 9 to 2, which is nearly a quarter of its original strength. Coming to the clinic scheduling and telemedicine, we began our telemedicine services from May 2020. Between the period of May and July 2020, a total of 330 patients were contacted. The map shows the distribution of the patients who sought our teleconsultation services, with the majority of them being from the state of Uttar Pradesh. 90% of the patients were conversant with the use of smartphones, and nearly 10% of all patients were contacted using video calls. Overall, majority of our patients were satisfied with the time given to them for teleconsultations, while the only issues faced were in relation to prescription, certain communication issues, and network issues, while the doctors primarily faced issues regarding patient examination due to inability to personally examine the patients. Overall, the patients found that telemedicine is quite beneficial as it reduces the risk of infection while also increasing the amount of time saved, as well as also reducing the cost borne by the patient in traveling with the dependent patient. Overall, majority of the patients found telemedicine to be an acceptable proposition till the end of COVID-19 pandemic. So telemedicine has a few issues in relation to the legal problems it poses, and also due to the certain remuneration issues which may arise from it. And for the doctors, it poses issues as we are unable to clinically examine patients. There may also be certain threats, as in some cases there may be misdiagnosis due to telemedicine, which could result in potential lawsuits. And in some cases, due to the lack of HIPAA compliance of the HIPAA Act, it may give rise to problems as well. However, it serves as an excellent opportunity for us to develop better laws, to also come up with better solutions for remuneration of patients, to develop better meeting platforms, and also to devise new appliances or technologies to examine patients in remote areas. Overall, the main strength of telemedicine lies in the fact that it reduces the cost, reduces infection to the patients, while also increasing the ease with which a patient is able to gain access to a specialist prior to visiting the hospital. Our physical OPDs were begun at the end of the lockdown phase in a staggered fashion. Acrylic polymer barriers were installed in all of our examination rooms, and we also had designated donning and doffing areas in the OPDs. In addition, it was made mandatory for all the faculty as well as the residents to wear level 1 PPE while in the OPD, and there was strict adherence to the rule of a single patient and attendant in the examination room to avoid any infections. Coming to the contact surveillance, in our department, once a patient or a healthcare worker tested positive by either RT-PCR or CVNAT testing, a period of infectivity was determined based on the 48 hours prior to symptom onset or 48 hours prior to a positive test. Based on the same, a list was prepared of all those exposed to the index case within these 48 hours, which was then communicated to the nodal officer who performed the risk stratification, following which the departmental contact tracing team carried out home quarantine and or testing of the high-risk contacts, while the low-risk contacts were advised to resume work but with added precautions. So overall, the departmental contact tracing team was responsible for screening of all the healthcare workers for symptoms prior to the onset of their shift, ensuring adequate protective measures such as hand hygiene, social distancing, and use of PPE, in addition to their activities of contact tracing and risk stratification under the guidance of the nodal officer. In addition, 13 overall from the period of March to July 2020, we found that 13 inpatients and 24 healthcare workers were COVID positive in our department. While the majority of the contacts were low risk, those who were high risk were tested and home quarantined accordingly. An important fact to note is that two patients who were diagnosed as COVID positive were done so after the RT-PCR gold standard testing, after their initial CVNAT test was negative in the previous 48 hours. So this serves as, this is of primary importance, as RT-PCR is essential for all inpatients, especially those undergoing surgeries, in order to avoid any infection both to the inpatients as well as also to the staff operating on the patient. Thank you. I would now like to invite Dr. Revanth to present the next part of the presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Niveda. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I am going to talk about the surgical scheduling strategies which we have developed during the COVID-19 era. First, as we all know, all the routine admissions and OPD services were closed since the evolution of epidemic pandemic. So, whatever we have admitted or evaluated through the emergencies. So, first we have to triage the patients based upon the risk criteria and then whether the patient will need admission or not. So basically, we have developed a protocol for triaging the patients from casualty based upon the urgency of surgical indication and the presence of influenza-like illness or acute respiratory infection-related symptoms, whether the patient has any high-risk contact with COVID-19 positive patients or patient living in a hotspot area. Basically, this protocol was devised initially in the initial stages of the pandemic. So the complete protocol for evaluation of the neurosurgical patients is depicted in this flowchart. Once we have evaluated the patient in the casualty, then if the patient is having any urgent life-threatening injury or any other condition, then the patient will be shifted to COVID suspect OR after taking the sample and sample for TrueNAT or a rapid antigen depending on the availability, and the patient will be shifted to ICUC after the OT. ICUC, basically we have converted the ICUC after the pandemic into our COVID suspect area, and after RT-PCR, we have started downgrading, we'll downgrade the patient from ICU-C to ICU-B or ward. During any of this process, if the patient test comes positive, then the patient will be shifted to COVID-19 designated area. And this checklist, during the initial stages, this checklist for COVID-19 suspicion acted as an important tool to identify the patients with high risk and also the stratification of these patients. Once the patient gets admitted from the casualty, then the triaging of for the neurosurgical procedures is being done based upon the urgency of neurosurgical intervention, whether there is life risk or not, or there is any other impending neurological impairment and the underlying pathology and the COVID-19 status of the patient. So the patient is stratified based upon the risk to life and the impending neurological impairment. If the condition is life-threatening, then the patient will be shifted immediately to OT after taking sample for TrueNAT or CBNAT. And if the operative testing, among the various tests available, so RT-PCR, which is considered as a gold standard, has a total time of around 8 hours. Within 8 hours, we can get the report. Whereas for the cartridge-based PCRs, GeneXpert and TrueNAT, they have their own set of advantages, being in the rapidity with which the report is available. And also, they are available round the clock. Whereas the rapid antigen kit with a total time of around 15 to 30 minutes, we can get a report, but they have very low sensitivity but high specificity. And IgG antibody based tests, these are usually used for sero surveillance. Even though RT-PCR is considered as a gold standard test, but most of the times if the patient is asymptomatic and if he is in 2 weeks before the in the pre-symptomatic stage, then the likelihood ratio of detecting the COVID-19 even through the RT-PCR is very difficult. So therefore, this is the reason basically to do RT-PCR twice before the elective surgeries or semi-emergency surgeries within a period of around 4 to 5 days, and the last test should be done within 1 to 2 days before surgery. As the pandemic has evolved since March, the testing capacity and the testing percentage have also been increased. Thanks to the Department of Microbiology, the testing capacity have increased from 50% in March to almost 100% from July, where now we are doing mandatory testing before surgery. So, since the beginning of the pandemic, we have developed guidelines for the preoperative testing of neurosurgery, which suggested that mandatory testing should be planned for all diagnostic procedures and surgical interventions, and also have categorized into two groups. Category 1 are the patients who are admitted for a diagnostic and therapeutic procedures. They should be tested with RT-PCR or TrueNAT or CBNAT or rapid antigen based upon the urgency. Whereas category 2 are the outpatients usually from our department, basically these are the gamma knife patients. They should be tested with RT-PCR. Corroborating with the evidence from our department, most of the societies across the world have recommended the preoperative testing should be mandatory, and at least 2 tests should be done within a period of around 4 to 5 days, and the second test preferably within 1 to 2 days before the surgery. Next, in all surgical disciplines, preoperative management plays a very important role to prevent the spread of COVID-19 in the OR and also to the healthcare workers. So in our department, we have devised so many protocols to control the spread of COVID-19 infection in the OR and also to healthcare workers. In the preoperative period, we have developed a separate COVID-19 related consent form along with the written informed consent, explaining the patient and their relatives about the risk of acquiring COVID infection during the hospital stay or during surgery or even in the post-operative period, and also associated morbidity and mortality after acquiring the COVID-19 infection. And in the OR, we are strictly implementing this checklist provided by Hospital Infection Control Committee to maintain the strict adherence to PPE donning and doffing. And we also developed some novel solutions to limit the spread of contamination in the OR. One such solution is a modified suction apparatus. Basically, in this, the suction cap, on the inside of the suction cap, there is the metallic chamber is connected, to which the rubber tube is connected, and this rubber tube should be long enough to reach the bottom of the bottle. This bottle usually contains fluid containing 0.1% hypochlorite solution, which is virucidal. And this bottle also collects the blood products and the irrigation products through the suction, which helps in disinfecting the fluid. So this mainly prevents the spread of transmission to healthcare workers who will be changing these bottles. And also one more solution. And also one more solution is the development of customized microscope drape, This is a simulated video which have done in the dry conditions, and we have used the betadine solution, a diluted betadine solution to look like blood.
High speed drilling.
And this drilling usually leads to high aerosol generation, which leads to spilling of these bone products, and even contamination and soiling of the operative surgeon and even the assisting surgeon. So we have devised this microscopic drape, which is draped around the microscope and is tied with loose laces, and it contains two apertures on either side for the assisting surgeon, and the suction tube can also be placed inside the drape, which helps in maintaining negative pressure micro environment, and also it helps in sucking the aerosols. The assisting surgeon can easily helps in the drilling, and also this environment prevents the aerosol spread. See, the soiling is only mainly inside the drape, and with a minimal soiling on the outside of the drape. With this prevents the spread of infection in the OR to the OR staff and even to the assisting surgeon when there is high risk of when there is high viral load. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Sarvesh to further continue with the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Raymond. Good afternoon, everyone. I am going to discuss about the comparison of the statistics of patients visiting our neurosurgical department during the COVID era to that of pre-COVID era. In this geographical representation, we can see that in 2019, between the period of March and June, about 12,000 patients visited our outpatient services. Comparatively, in 2020, in the same time period, initially only tele OPD consultations were done, and later on physical OPD consultations were started. A total of 274 patients were consulted in this manner, and this signifies that COVID-19 has had a drastic impact on our outpatient services. In this diagram, we can see that in March, when COVID-19 lockdown was imposed, only 28 surgeries could be performed from the day of lockdown till the end of March. In the coming months of April, May and June, although the COVID-19 cases continued to rise, we were able to perform between 60 to 80 surgeries per month with the help of anesthesia team and with the help of better preoperative testing and better departmental policies. Although this is way less than 250 surgeries per month which we perform normally. In this diagram, we have compared the statistic of our department between March and June 2020 to March and June 2019. We see that there has been 99% decrease in our outpatient services consultation, 72% decrease in the number of patient admission, 75% decrease in the number of surgeries that we have done, and 30% decrease in the number of emergency surgeries that we have done. In this table, we have described the statistic of our department in various phases of lockdown. We see that from 25th March to 30th June this year, we have admitted 251 patients, out of which 42 patients turned out COVID positive in our emergency triage area, and they were later shifted to COVID-19 designated area for further management. A total of 170 patients were operated during this phase, out of which 36 patients had a COVID-19 indeterminate or suspect status prior to surgery. One patient out of these 36 patients was later found to be COVID positive and was later shifted to a trauma center for further management. 134 patients had a COVID-19 negative status prior to surgery proven by CBNAT or RT-PCR. Two patients out of these 134 patients was later found to be COVID positive and shifted to trauma center for further management. In this cohort of 251 patients, we had an 11% mortality. Now I would like to invite Dr. Varith for further discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Sarvesh. I would be discussing about the impact that this COVID-19 pandemic has had over the neurosurgical training and education. In a survey that was conducted among the neurosurgeons practicing all over the country, irrespective of their training status, out of a total of 207 respondents, a vast majority, 92% of the respondents agreed that pandemic is going to adversely impact the training of neurosurgical residents. Also, around 53% believe that pandemic is going to negatively impact the research work as well. In another survey that was conducted among the neurosurgical residents, we had around 118 respondents from across 29 different neurosurgery programs in India, and it revealed that there has been a significant decrease in not only the number of surgeries performed or assisted per month by the residents, but also in the number of academic sessions conducted per week. Coming on to what happened at our center, in the 4-month period of March to June last year, we conducted around 51 seminars, 42 journal clubs, 32 bedside clinical case presentations, 34 neuroradiology combined rounds. While for the same duration, this year during COVID, we could conduct only 8 seminars and 8 journal clubs, and the bedside clinical case presentation and NRCs reduced to 0. Similarly, there was a significant decrease in the cases operated or assisted by the residents this year. While the emergency non-trauma cases decreased from 332 to 239, around 80% of previous year, the routine non-trauma cases were completely halted. Even the trauma surgeries reduced to just 20% of the previous year values. The decrease in the number of cases operated or assisted by the residents, as well as the academic sessions, reflects actually the quality of the resident training we are providing. The same has been reiterated in several studies from across the globe. Now we have tried to revamp the neurosurgical education using online journal clubs, seminars, grand rounds. We have even conducted live online cadaveric courses. We have conducted operative neurosurgery masterclass, like on cavernous sinus surgery by Professor Alicrest, on Moyamoya disease by Professor Takizawa, on trigeminal schwannoma by Professor Coolwell, and on spine surgery by Professor Kale. But the fact remains that we have been able to make a very small dent in a very large problem that is specially relevant to the surgical disciplines because of the need for OR-based learning and particularly important for neurosurgery with a longer surgical learning curve. To summarize, for the infrastructure and resource allocation related challenges, we had to convert the satellite blocks into COVID-19 dedicated facilities. We had to suspend all the elective admissions and the routine neurosurgical procedures, and we restructured the workforce into team system. For infection control related challenges, we created electronic medical record system to prevent the risk of fomite transmission, and we resorted to conducting online meetings using platforms like Google Meet and WebEx to prevent the risk of cross-infection on physical daily rounds. For surgical related challenges, we decreased the number of operating rooms from 9 to 2 to address the need for donning and doffing areas. We revamped the air conditioning system of the ORs to prevent the spread of virus. And as you saw, we created several novel innovative drapes and suction devices. To address the difficulty in using microscope wearing PPE, we resorted to use of newer technologies like 3D and 2D exoscopes. For resident neurosurgical training related challenges, we conducted several virtual ORs, seminars on operative techniques and 3D anatomy, and special online classes on clinical assessment by national and international faculty. All the data that has been presented in this CCR is from different papers that have already been published or are accepted for publication in various journals of national and international repute. In conclusion, I would like to say that though telemedicine offers a viable alternative to some extent for physical outpatient services, and protocol-based management has played a vital role in reducing transmission risk to healthcare workers, and a meticulous pre-operative testing strategy has kept any in-hospital outbreaks in check, but the worst that has suffered during this COVID-19 pandemic is the neurosurgical resident training. Due to infrastructure reorganization, reallocation of manpower, reduced bed capacity, complete halting of routine neurosurgical procedures, and a near-complete absence of bedside teaching. Therefore, if we want to maintain the quality of residency training at our institute, the need of the hour is a major administrative step to address this issue. I would like to thank the AIIMS COVID-19 Task Force, the Hospital Infection Control Committee and the Department of Microbiology, and our sister departments of Neuroanesthesia and Neuroradiology.